Welcome, everybody. My name is Todd Keirstead, and you are watching TK Talks, Stories of Inspiration, both on and off the golf course. I have with me today Adam Benza. Adam, how are you doing today, pal?
Doing well, yourself?
Doing really, really well. Now, let's get right into it, man. You started golf at a really early age. You were 3 years old?
I did, yeah. You know, luckily, I had, you know, my father and my grandfather who were, you know, really into golf. So they were able to get me out in the course pretty much, you know, as soon as I could start walking and doing stuff. So I was, you know, really lucky to be able to start playing at that age.
You know what? Really good childhood memories. That's how I got into it, with playing with my dad. And I would never be able to get that time back that we spent with our families on the golf course. So kudos to you. So what sports other than golf did you grow up playing?
I mean, I played everything. Baseball. I was a big baseball player. Basketball, football, soccer. I pretty much played everything. And then it wasn't until I got more focused in when I was in high school that I started getting into golf.
Okay, so let's back it up now. Let's go back to you being 9 years old. What ended up happening?
This is actually a good story. So I was playing like street hockey with my brother in our garage. And of course, I was the goalie, so he could just take slap shots at me. Whatever, that's fine. Hits me in my shin, pretty much halfway up my shin. Probably like bruised really bad for a couple days. My parents were just like, shin splints, don't worry about it. Maybe 2 weeks later, we go out, we do the same thing, hits me in the exact same spot. Doesn't get any better. Go to a sports medicine institute and did an x-ray and they're like, you know, you have bone cancer. So from that, went down to AI DuPont in Wilmington, Delaware. Pretty much from then on, just got diagnosed with Ewing sarcoma. Everything was going good. And then pretty much a year into it, after a donor bone, one of the screws got infected and they gave me an option to either redo the donor bone or to amputate. And pretty sure we could all figure out what one I chose.
Right. So what kind of a decision was that for you? Was it something that you did on your own? Obviously, there was communication with your parents, but at the end of the day, was it your decision?
Yeah, you know, I never knew this, and I was kind of upset about it at the time, is that my parents never told me that that was an option in the beginning. And, you know, granted, parents looking out, you know, for me, and I appreciate it, to, you know, they want to give me as much of a normal life as I possibly could have. But, you know, without knowing how I would react to an amputation. So when that option came down, they let me make the decision.
So how long then was the limb salvage procedure going on?
Probably about 6 to 8 months I had that donor bone. And then, you know, it was just one day. It had to be amputated immediately because there was just a big pocket of pus surrounding the screw. And he's like, you know, we need to go in right now. My fever was through the roof. So they needed to go in. So there wasn't really any time to wait. Then after that, I mean, after I was amputated, I was a couple months.
Wow. So the recovery time was pretty quick. With you being 9 years old, you wanted to get right back out playing with your friends again.
Yeah. You know, and that's pretty much what it came down to is when I asked the doctor, I'm like, you know, can I still do everything that I want to do? And can I get, you know, out doing things sooner, you know, with it amputated? You know, being a young kid, you know, being in a hospital for the past year, you want to get out and just be with your friends and do stuff.
So then you got into high school. You decided golf was your go-to then.
Yeah, I played pretty much everything, but I really kind of found my passion and excelled in golf. And so then I, you know, I wanted to take that and make a kind of a future out of it. And I felt like that was, you know, I couldn't make baseball a future, but, you know, golf gave me some avenues to do what I wanted to do.
So where has golf taken you now?
Well, after high school, I went to Penn State for professional golf management. Throughout that, I got involved with actually my longtime neighbor, who's also an amputee. His name's Bob Buck. He runs the Eastern Amputee Golf Association, who's a phenomenal man. And after years of nagging me to get involved with playing an amputee golf, and it was funny because it was one of those things where I'm like, I'm better than these guys. I'm not playing with them. I'll kill them. until you get into a tournament, you're like, oh man, whoops. But yeah, so I got involved with him. He asked me to come with my, you know, with what I've learned with teaching and from Penn State, he, you know, asked me to come out, get involved with the EAGA and start doing some of his, some of their first swing learn to golf clinics. And after that, you know, I was like, you know, let me just see where, you know, this kind of goes.
So life has really taken it full circle. You went from having to relearn the swing again to now working with other people now that are in adaptive situations.
Yeah. And honestly, it's, I like to be self-proclaimed the best disabled golf teacher because I am the most disabled out of anybody because actually 3 years ago, I had a stroke too. So I went through like everything. So I'm like, you know, I've dealt with, you know, kind of memory loss and things like that. And it's still to this day, a little short-term memory loss that I'll like get over a shot and be like, I don't know what I'm trying to do here.
So was there any kind of situations that brought that stroke on or?
No, totally random.
Wow. And what about now, you know, when you're playing in the heat, when you're playing in certain conditions, does it affect the memory?
Honestly, no, it's just like, it's kind of random. It's just like, and it's really just short-term memory. That it, you know, so, I mean, that's the only thing that becomes a big issue is that, you know, like when you're playing golf and you're on the fly and you need to make an adjustment, it then becomes a little more difficult to do it. But, you know, working through that more and more, I'm able to kind of rebound from it and know what I have to do.
Now let's talk about the competition side of you. You know, tell me some of the placings and finishes that you've had.
I mean, if it depends on how much my mind gets involved. The best finish that I've ever had in our national amputee tournament was second last year. I'm typically always in the top 10. I've won 3 Eastern Regional Championships, a Southwest Regional Championship. I've won my amputee division nationally 2 times. I've won 6 club championships, 3 match play championships, 3 stroke play championships. I've played in US Open qualifiers, Mid-Am qualifiers.
I kind of feel like, you know, when Phil Mickelson was telling Tiger to, remember when it was being announced on the stage and he's like, okay, get on with it. Dude, man, you got quite the career. Good for you. Now, do you find that the teaching side of it gets in the way a little bit of your playing? And do you think maybe, you know, your game could be a little bit better if you didn't go in that direction?
You know, at this stage of my life, I'm, you know, I love playing. I love competing. But at the same time, it's where we're at right now in disabled golf. It's more to the point where we need people to get out. So if I can get people out there playing, I mean, that to me is the most important, you know, give me 2 weeks, I'll go figure out how to hit it. So teaching really doesn't get in the way. The only thing that it hinders a little bit, and I should stop doing it, is to go, like personally, I'm a visual learner. So kind of, I like to teach that way. So I will show my students, this is what you're doing visually, and I'll make those swings, and then all of a sudden you start hitting, like catching it off the hosel, hitting 50 yard slice, and you're like, I need to go to the range for 3 hours to forget what I just did.
It's tough, man. I've been teaching for a lot of years as well too, and you get those bad, I'm not gonna call them bad swings, but you get those bad swings in your head and you see them, and with being a visual guy, yeah man, that's really easy to fall into that trap.
Yeah, so that's the only difficult situation that's going on, but I mean, other than that, I love it. And it's the people that you get to meet, and not just meet, but then, you know, see them out at more clinics or see them, you know, at tournaments. That's kind of what you want to do.
Now you're involved with a nonprofit called Moving Forward. Tell us a little bit about that.
You know, I thought about this for a long time, and it's kind of Bob Buck wanted to kind of step away from doing the first swing clinics. It's a lot, and it's a lot to take on. So I was like, you know, with my background, I'll be more than happy to do it, but what better to do it with than, you know, compile some of, you know, the best players in the world. You know, you have instant credibility to be able to go out and instruct these people, but you know, from, you know, top disabled golfers. And with that, you know, being in the, going through the PGM program, you were never taught how to teach people with disabilities. And I, you know, I thought that was a real shame that the PGA really didn't put, you know, an issue on that, because, you know, off the top of my head, just amputees, there's roughly like 180,000 amputations done every year in the United States. If you want to grow the game of golf, they're, you know, grow in all facets, women, kids, but you're having, even if you get a quarter, an eighth of 180,000 people a year, I mean, you're growing the game so much, and it's such a good sport to get people out doing that. I mean, that was, it was really sad for me to see that. And I, you know, after a couple beers, I was like, man, this is a great idea. So I called all three of them up and I was like, hey, how do you guys feel about doing this? And they all jumped on board.
So you did that after a couple beers. Can you imagine if we went through a case, man? It would be the sky's the limit, right?
No, I didn't want to go that far, but it might have been close to that.
Dude, man, I love it. This is what TK Talks is all about, sharing inspirational stories both on and off the golf course. Adam, it was an absolute pleasure today. Thank you so much for being a part of it. I know you're doing some great stuff. I know you're inspiring a lot of people, and I look forward to continuing seeing the successes that you're having.
I mean, thank you so much for having me on. I appreciate it, just to get out there and, you know, especially for you getting it out there to people so that they could see what's going on in the world of disabled golf.
Well, man, you're living and breathing it every day. So thank you so much for everything that you're doing.
Thank you.